I'm going to show you the top 5 mixing tips that all electronic dance music producers should be using. So let's get into it. Welcome to another video, everyone. My name is Daniel Strongen. If this is your first time here and you want to learn all things music production related when it comes to mixing, mastering, sound design, arrangement, then go ahead and click the subscribe button and the bell notification next to it so you don't miss anything. So starting with the first mixing tip that all electronic music producers should know. This is to avoid phasing issues. Today's music has a very wide stereo image. All the different plugins available to us to stereo spread our sounds have never been better, have never been more advanced, and help us get a very wide sound. But what many producers don't know is that this can cause a lot of phasing issues in your track, especially in dance music, as it's mostly played in clubs. So why would I care about the phasing issues if I already have my stereo spread is going, everything seems fine, right? Well, the problem with this is that with club sound systems, they're going to convert your song to mono to play on their system. And when you have these very wide stereo images and you collapse your sound into mono, oftentimes there will be phasing issues. It will sound kind of muddy and it'll lose a lot of its power. One specific technique that is very common in electronic music is the Haas delay. This Haas delay technique is used all across electronic dance music and is great for widening up your sounds and not great for the mono compatibility of your song. So the Haas delay is simply putting on a delay plugin on your sound, setting the dry wet to 100%, then turning the time for one of the channels down to 0 seconds, and then turning the time on the other channel to around 15 to 25 milliseconds. This super small delay is not going to be perceived by the human ear and is going to perceived as a wider sound and not a delay. So this is a good technique for spreading your sounds, but it does cause the phasing issues that we were talking about. So I would recommend using another technique for spreading your sounds instead of using this Haas delay technique and instead of using all those stereo imagers. So what I like to do to spread my sounds is to pan the sound hard left, then make another channel and spread it hard right. After that, I like to put on a pitching plugin on both the channels and then detune one channel by plus 13 cents and then the other channel by negative 13 cents. What this does is it creates the perception of a really wide stereo image from its hard left and hard right pan channels, and the extra detuning of the sounds adds that extra width and avoids phasing issues when converted to mono. Tip number 2 is to boost smart. This is a very subtle tip, but it has a big overall effect on your track. So instead of just boosting frequencies, why not boost frequencies that are in the key of your song? A lot of today's modern EQ, such as Pro Q2 or GMG's Equilibrium, will have readouts of the notes when you're hovering over specific frequencies in your EQ. So that will make boosting the frequencies in your track very easy to do, as you can already see the note that it is playing when you're hovering over it. And for those of us who don't have EQs that give readouts of the specific notes that you're hovering over, you can go ahead and check the frequency chart down in the description. In this chart, you're going to have all the different notes and their specific frequencies, so you know exactly what frequency to boost, so it's in the key of your track. Like I said, this will add up over all the boosting that you do in your song and create a stronger harmonic gel to your track. And tip number 3 is to monitor the low end of your track or sub frequencies. Electronic music relies heavily on these clean, powerful sub frequencies to create that big impact. So having a clean mix down there is super important to the overall success of your track. So what I like to do to monitor this low end is to throw an EQ on the master channel and then put a high cut on at around 400 hertz. And then I start the mixing of my kick, sub, and basses this way. When you have a bunch of high frequencies in your mix, it is hard to concentrate on the lower end frequencies, so cutting them away will help you focus on just the low frequencies, so you know you're keeping it clean and you know which frequencies to cut. Tip number 4 is to have correct panning positions. The human ear can only perceive a limited number of panning positions at one time, so keeping panning simple in your tracks is really important here. So when I'm mixing in my elements, I like to mix them into the 5 different panning positions that are most recognizable by the human hearing. And those 5 panning positions are hard left, mid left, center, mid right, and hard right. So putting your elements into one of these five panning positions will help your ear recognize where it is in the stereo field and will give you a cleaner and more understandable mix. And tip number five is to have a strong mid-range in your track. Yes, the high end and the sub is important in your track, but it's the mid-range that gives your track that fullness, that big sound. And oftentimes the mid-range is overlooked as most producers focus on the sub and high frequencies. So pay attention to the mid-range of your track from around 150 hertz to 1K. And if you feel like the power is lacking in these frequencies, you can do one simple trick. You can open up a return slash send channel, and then on that return and send channel, you can put on an EQ, and on that EQ, you're going to low cut at around 150 hertz, and then high cut at 1K. So now that we got the high range and sub frequencies out of this channel, we're going to then put on a saturator. Throw on your favorite saturation plugin. The goal here is just to warm up the sound and give that mid-range a little more bite, a little more presence. And the last effect that we're gonna put on this return slash send channel is an over-the-top compression plugin, or OTT. And this OTT does a form of downward compression and upward expansion to bring out the quieter parts and bring it more front and center in the mix. It's a little more aggressive than a saturation and distortion plugin in terms of the presence that it gives in the mix. Then once you have these three plugins set up on your return slash send channel, then you can start adding elements to this return slash send to give a bigger mid-range. I recommend starting with your synths here, but really experimenting is key. Throw in your drums, throw in your vocals, so you can really add presence in the mid-range. But be careful here, as you can easily muddy up the mix with adding too much mid-range to your track. So as always, it's trying to find that balance in between what gives that weight and what gives that tubbiness. Thank you for watching the video, everyone. If you enjoyed it, go ahead and give the video a thumbs up. And if you wanna learn more about electronic music production when it comes to mixing, mastering, sound design, and arrangement, go ahead and hit the subscribe button right here and stay up to date with when I release videos. Till next time, everyone.